Not everything metal was created equal.
What an ugly thing to say.
The Metal Sucks Podcast. Shiggity Chuck and Godless attempt to bring order to chaos or just make stupid jokes about dumb people.
Stupid. A person below normal intelligence.
This is the Metal Sucks Podcast.
Greetings and salutations, my fine metal friends. Welcome to another edition of the Metal Sucks Podcast. How you doing? I'm Chuck.
I am Godless.
And this is your weekly examination of all things metal, the Metal Sucks Podcast. Let's see. What do we got?
Subscribe on iTunes.
Where am I? There you go. Okay. I'm like, what do I start with? I forget these things sometimes, man. Make sure you subscribe on iTunes. Look for Metal Sucks Podcast. You can find it. You can search it. You can get us on Stitcher and a couple other podcasting apps. Make sure you find us there and download us every week. Subscribe. That way it comes to you. Leave us 5 stars and tell us that we suck. That's always good.
This is the website every Monday.
Monday is when we post it, and you can get all kinds of exciting things like today, our interview with Jean-Paul Gaster of the Mighty Clutch.
I'm so looking forward to re-listening because I haven't heard it since when we did it.
I know. And we just did it last week because it was the last show of their tour right before they were going into the studio here in Texas, actually, because Machine, who has done so many other CDs.
You're a close personal friend.
I met the guy on a panel. He moved to Texas. And so he's got his machine shop now out in the country here in Texas, and Clutch is here for the next month. Like recording their new record, which is
do you realize cool. When you say that, like, almost everybody outside of Texas hears that's the sound of Machine's recording studio, you know? It's like,
hey man, no,
people with big hats and
spurs. Exactly. Hey man, I'll tell you what, they're gonna make a country album. It's a Clutch country album, gonna be great. Tell you what, man, hey, come on, dude, Ministry made their shit in West Texas, so
I you know, they were awesome in concert.
Yeah,
they played two or three, I think it was three new sort of sketches, I guess is the best you can call it.
Yeah, that's what I would say. I think, like I said, I was like, you were sort of skeptical.
I'm nervous.
But see, me, I hear that and I'm like, oh, this is pre-producer writing is what it is. It's like, this is before anybody gets to it, you know what I'm saying?
Well, the good thing is that Clutch are not going to be doing a covers album.
No, they are not. And that was one of the things we wanted to talk about. Look at you with the segue. Woo! Oh, look at your brilliance over here. Yeah. Lovely. No, you brought it up, actually, because you saw what? Prong's cover album that they're going to be doing, they're coming out with. And it kind of sprung into a little bit broader topic about cover albums in general, because Prong's... They're coming out with a cover album that's called Songs from the Black Hole, which, you know, is not like a euphemism, I don't think, or at least it might be. You never know.
As soon as I saw that title, I'm like, you better not be covering Soundgarden, man, because I hate that song.
Let's do the entire Soundgarden record.
Well, it's like, if you're going to cover a Soundgarden song, you do not cover Black Hole Sun. Not because Soundgarden did it so great that nobody else should do it. It's just that it's such an incredibly bad song that everybody should ignore its existence.
So Prong picked a bunch of songs that I would not have picked for anybody to cover, which can be a good thing because it's one of those cool things sometimes where a band covers a song and you're like, oh, that's a great song. You don't even realize that it's a cover. And some of these songs that they have on here are... very broad. I mean, it's very random. I mean, you know, I know the Fugazi song pretty well. I know the Bad Brain song pretty well. I know Neil Young, obviously. Sisters of Mercy, which I think is fucking great. You know, I was like, that's beautiful.
Wait, are they going to do Cortez the Killer with like 12 minutes of guitar solos?
Probably.
Oh.
Except it's going to be bass solos.
See, the problem with any band covering Cortez the Killer is that you're going to spend the rest of your career with everybody dreading going to see you in concert in case you might play Cortez the Killer. You know what I mean? It's true. A great song, but... Oh,
but, man. You know, they picked a few things that are just sort of like, wow, what? Black Flag. Okay, you pick a Black Flag song, you're going to use bars. Really? Okay, that's sort of an odd one to pick from them. Husker Du, which I think it's sort of strange and random to pick a Husker Du song to cover.
Well, it could be better than
first place.
Bob Mould solo, you know? Right. I mean,
yeah, no kidding.
Standing on the edge of the...
And I know Discharge, but I'm not sure. You know what I mean? It's like, I don't know. So
wait a minute, rewind. I would like to hear Prong cover Hoover Dam by Bob Mould.
So is this like a... Do you think this is representative of who they are? Like, is this is like the... We talked about that. It's covers of stuff where it comes from. So you listen to like Slayer's Undisputed Attitude, right?
Right.
And you had no idea. Like you never put together the punk influence in this thrash metal thing that they had going on until you heard that. And you're like, oh, fuck, that's where all that DB stuff comes from.
Exactly.
You're like, oh, no wonder. Now I kind of get that tie-in and how it sounds hardcore in some respects.
Yeah, because all the old guys are like, I hear Slayer, they just sound like fast punk rock. And you're like, screw that, man. That's not fast punk rock.
I don't hear
rock.
That.
That's Slayer.
Yeah.
And Slayer then, is Slayer.
And then you hear Undisputed Attitude, and you're like, wait a minute.
Those old guys are right.
What are you talking about, man?
Yeah, totally. And then, but like, all right, so I had two reactions. My second reaction was, after seeing the lineup of songs that Prong were doing, was, oh, yeah, Slayer's Undisputed Attitude, right? But my initial reaction, I got to say, is in the wake of the last Prong album, which, dude, I beg to differ, prove you wrong. I mean, these are metal classic albums as far as I'm concerned. They are a couple of the best metal albums all times.
What?
Beg to differ, prove you wrong. Those are awesome albums. But the last Prong album, oh.
Oh, well, yeah. It fell a little flat.
And so my initial reaction is like, you know, like you hear that album and you're like, oh my God, Prong are out of ideas.
Yeah, so why does a band put out a
covers
album?
Yeah.
Is it because they're done, like, creatively? They've got nothing going on?
When I see the headline, Prong have a cover album, I'm thinking, they're telling me exactly what my reaction was after I listened to the last album, which is, you're out of ideas.
I need something familiar. Or is it like trying to return to form? I mean, because what I referenced was like Between the Bear and Me. They came out with The Anatomy Of, and that was basically kind of a finger to their record label that they were leaving at the time because they had to put one more record out, or else they couldn't leave the label kind of thing. So they did a covers album and got out of their contract kind of thing, or at least that was according to Tommy. But the thing about that is, though, is that what they did with that, and that's like one of my favorite records, is it kind of gave an insight into who they were as a band. And you go, okay, well, you're playing Day I Tried to Live from Soundgarden. You're playing Smashing Pumpkins song. You're playing Us and Them from Pink Floyd. You're playing Sepultura's Territory. And you kind of hear these influences in their music. That some things that I didn't even realize were there.
Right, sort of the same thing that you had happen with Undisputed Attitude.
So is this kind of one of the... Well, and then they return what seems invigorated and come out with their new record is like, boom. So is it also kind of a self-examination thing too? You know, so could this be Prong going back to their roots going, this is really where we come from. Now, and giving it some of that credence,
they went back to their roots.
Well, no, I mean, like, fucking finding out where the fuck you come from sometimes.
Every single album a band does, they went back to their roots.
Hey, man.
Why doesn't a band ever say, you know what, we've decided screw our roots.
That's
we're going to impersonate everything.
As a reviewer, there are only so many sentences as an album reviewer that you can write. You go back to your roots, the traditional way that you examine, fuck off.
Unless you're playing a rattle, you know, you're not going back to your roots.
But no, I mean, sometimes you really like you go because I mean, you look at the list of songs that they have that are on this record. And you're like, well, wait a minute, I never would have put these together. But then maybe if you listen to it, you're like, oh, I hear where Snap Your Finger, Snap Your Neck comes from. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I hear where these things come from because I never would have added that up until I hear this. And that could be the same thing. It could be a result of that. Anthems for Anthrax, you know, was more of a tribute record to me. That felt like, you know, I mean,
it's interesting the way bands do covers albums for different reasons. You know what I mean? And by the way, I was totally ripping off Todd Berry earlier. I got to give that. They went back to the roots. That's a Todd Berry thing. Okay. So anyway, everybody does covers albums for different reasons, and the pessimist in me is that Prong are like, well, we got to put out something. But the optimist in me is that Prong are doing
what I'm talking about.
Yeah, or what every band should do at some point, which is like, you know what? We forgot what really makes us great, and so what we're going to do is we're going to impersonate bands that we know got it right and we're gonna just do it A to Z exactly the way they did it.
Roots.
Yes, and
see,
and then when we come out of that, we're gonna just, that's gonna stick with us. And I think that there's a real value in that.
Yeah, there possibly could be.
I just wish you did it as an EP instead of an LP. You know? Well,
yeah, I guess so. But I mean, why not? I mean, it's so be. And who knows?
Want a tour?
And who knows? There could be another motive behind that too. Just like it was for Between the Bear and Me. You know, yeah. I mean, there could be something else in that as well, you know, not having talked to Tommy, you know, so it's like, well, I'm not sure.
Well, if we reached out to Tommy and said, do you want to talk to us? If he says no, then that means that they're doing it to get out of a contract. And if he says yes, then they believe in what they're doing, right?
Well, I don't know. I think it's interesting to see. And I mean, I think there are so many different reasons to do it. I always found it weird when a band included a cover song on their album.
Yes, I agree with that.
Like, I always thought that was really strange.
In the internet age, it definitely is.
Yeah, because I mean, if it wasn't like a bonus track or like a deluxe edition of the record or something like that, whereas an extra that came on it or something like mm-hmm. that. Was it Arsis that put Sunglasses at Night like dead yeah. center of that record?
But that worked.
Well, that was a great song.
Yes.
It was a great cover, but I still thought that was just, what the fuck are you doing putting this in the middle of the record? But I want to say that if you break it, if you broke that album down A and B side, like that was the last song on the A side, if I remember right. But, you know, who does that
who
anymore?
Who does that anymore?
But to me, it's like, that's the thing, is that if you're going to do a cover song on a record, you bury it. You make it an extra. It's something else like that. I always thought that was very strange for a band to stick up cover song.
You toss that Arsis in there, and man,
now you're thinking, I wear my sunglasses.
It's so good. And I'd be worried if I had gotten.
I don't know why that was the one that popped in my head.
But if I'd gotten that album and I didn't get Sunglasses at Night, I think I'd be bummed. I mean, it's a great, great, great death metal album.
Well, yeah. No. It's a great death metal album, but I still feel weird about it covering it.
It should be like track 11, you know?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. It should be like the final track or a bonus track or a hidden track or something of that nature, so that you can get that extra.
You don't hide Sunglasses at Night.
That's the whole point, man. You wear that shit out front, man. That's what I'm saying, because I wear my sunglasses because, you know, my future's so bright and shit. Yeah.
Yeah. I
make some more 80s references.
And then, you know, then the whole argument comes, are you going to do it the way, as close to the original, or are you going to do something new with it? And some people are like, man, that's the way the song is. That's the way you play the song. And I don't agree with that at all. I want to hear how you're going to mess with it.
Well, I actually think it depends on, I think that depends on who you are, or how you feel about that particular song. You know, like if I like doing a Thin Lizzy song for Anthrax, you know, having Jailbreak sound like Jailbreak was sort of important, because I think to them, that's one of those songs. Like, it should sound like that. But then when I hear Between the Bear and Me was a good example of it, actually. I really love that record. I don't know if you can tell. But their Day I Tried to Live was aggressive and like it was meaty. But then Territory sounded just like the original. Us and Them sounded just like the original. And then they took tangents with Smashing Pumpkins songs and other things. So some songs were perfect. Other songs were BT Bammed. You know what I mean? So like they did both. And I think that you kind of have that opportunity when you do an entire record of that. You can kind of change it up.
Yeah, but I'm not sure. You know, if you're going to do it exactly the way it was done, it's an exercise. It's a way of you just like trying to
Or it says
learn what they did, like I was talking about earlier. Yeah, you're in the creative drought.
But I think it also kind of says what you feel about that song. Like, that song is so important to you that it needs to be done the same way.
Yeah, but why are you going to ask everybody else to pay for it?
Well, I mean, because you can. I mean, so?
No, that's kind of bullshitty.
No, I think it's totally fine. I don't see anything wrong with it, man.
You got to put your own flair on it if you're going to charge.
Well, it's going to be your own flair a little bit anyway. I mean, not like fucking...
I don't know. I mean, there's that Saint Anger thing that popped up on the internet this week, right? Dude.
Yeah, well, that's a whole nother bitch.
I mean, maybe their voice is Metallica, you know what I mean?
What I would love to see with that, because I have no idea how that happened and whether or not those guys are going to get like sued to the fucking wall for that. No. You know, did Metallica authorize that for them to play their entire record?
But they give publishing if they make any money on it, and that's it.
Well, yeah, but no, you have to have like rights to record it and put it out and all that stuff.
No, you just got to pay publishing.
Yeah, I don't know about all that.
I don't know. I suspect, and you know, they're cushioning the blow.
There's a thing called a cease and desist.
Two of those dudes are wearing Metallica t-shirts. They'll be cool.
Right, we're advertising. Come on.
Yeah, so if you go on the web, there's somebody did like a full cover, the full album. Yeah,
it's on the top bar at MetalSucks.net.
Okay, cool, yeah.
And it's and they did a good job with it, actually. I never thought Frantic sounded good until I heard their version of it. I was like, oh.
Hmm.
Huh.
I mean, it's not deep.
It's not a great song. I mean,
it's an awful Saint album. Anger's
not a, well, no, it is an awful album, but it sounds better. It actually sounds like a local band should be doing it, right? But that's the thing is that when a local band does it, it's like, okay, all right, it sounds pretty good.
You remember when there was like MTV Unplugged and it was so great because a band would go up there, they get their acoustic guitars and you'd be like, wow, there's a really good song underneath whatever song. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And you strip everything away, it's still a great song. Saint Anger, I don't care who plays that album. That's still an awful album.
It's pretty fucking terrible.
It's terrible. And so all right, so this was my thing. Why are you covering it almost true to form? Why not take those songs and try to make them good?
What I think they were doing was proving that the problem with Saint Anger was not just, or trying to prove, that the problem with Saint Anger wasn't the songwriting as much as it was the mix. Like, the damage done in that was really the way it was recorded.
I don't know.
And I swear to you that if Bob Rock had not been the one that managed that thing, and personally, like, just changing the drums would have made it a completely different record for me, because for me it's that snare, the ding ding ding, the tin can that he's beating on the entire time, that makes it unlistenable. Like, yeah. You can't even listen to it.
Oh yeah,
it hurts so bad. That's the thing. Like, if and he's like, I want it to sound like they're in a garage. It's like, well, they're not in a fucking garage, right, dude. It's fucking Metallica, man.
Yeah.
So
they paid you how much to make it sound like? Yeah, I swear to God, I think
they should have paid some dude $200 and actually did it in a garage to see how it turned out.
Bob Rock, I picture he sits in his home and he's laughing as he just spills the dollar bills over himself. But if Metallica is playing in the background, he's laughing and crying at the same time over the damage that guy did.
Well, I don't know, man. I mean, or is it just like an extreme troll? I think it was just an extreme troll. It's like, oh, you want a drum sound that sounds like it's in a garage, huh? Here.
So it's like him. Ha-ha! It's like him and the guy who was like Brian Wilson's psychologist, the two of them like hanging out of the bar. Are laughing their asses off?
Maybe.
I mean,
it's entirely possible.
Who's done more damage to music than Bob Rock and that asshole?
I can probably think of a few people here and there.
There ought to be that should be a panel of South by Southwest.
Hall of Fame. Who's done the most damage to rock and roll?
Yeah, totally. But I think that I found it weird because I listened to that cover of Saint Anger and I was left with, oh my God, it was, the songs are just as bad as production. There was just nothing redeeming about it.
I thought it was definitely better, at least.
Okay.
More than anything.
I don't know. Is there any other album that you'd love to have some unknown band like actually do an awesome job with it?
Oh, like
out of nowhere type of thing?
Like a terrible record?
Or a record that is underappreciated, maybe?
Hmm.
An unknown with an album that was sort of known. I mean, could somebody do Lulu?
Nobody can do that. No, no, no. There's no way.
I mean, I think, you know, God killing Lou Reed was just his contribution to making sure Lulu 2 doesn't happen.
Yeah, right.
Who was it who said that? Was it Tyranny of Tradition?
Somebody, great line.
Yeah.
I tell you what. No, I don't know, man. I can't think of anybody who I'd want to go back and, like, you know, because you hear those bands that get a new lead singer and they want to re-record their old shit, right?
I love that.
Who did that? Like Exodus, or was it Exodus or Testament or somebody who did that?
Exodus did.
Where they re-recorded like some old shit.
Yeah, it was their first album.
Yeah.
Bonded by Blood.
Yeah. And it was like, oh.
Bonded by Blood's a pretty overrated record anyway.
But
it's
whatever.
Interesting, you know, that somebody, I love the idea of like, you know.
At Godless Speaks on Twitter.
Screw the old vocalist. We're going to, you know, I think that there's real validity.
And then let's
to that.
Get him back. All right. That's a great idea.
That's tough conversation to have,
right?
I imagine.
No shit, it is. Yeah,
all right. Hey, I'd love to know, have the words Bonded by Blood passed the lips of anybody in Exodus in the last 8 months?
Yeah, outside of the stage.
Yeah, right. No way.
All right. We got to get to our interview with Jean-Paul Gaster of the Mighty Clutch, man. They made a stop here in Austin, their last tour date. And I guess you could call it they're still on the Earth Rocker tour.
Do you think they make the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame?
Who? Clutch?
Yeah.
I would definitely hope so.
They should, right? At this point, they should.
But there's so many people that need to go. I mean, come on. If Kiss isn't in there, come on.
Well, they're in there now.
Well, yeah, I know now. But yeah, I'm saying it's how long did it take? Really?
Yeah.
Yeah, so.
Well, let's give Clutch another 15 years.
More. I'd say 2025. It'll take that long. But I think, yeah, they should be.
We should have asked that, and I didn't think of it.
Well, we asked a lot of other questions.
We did.
About stuff and things. Jean-Paul Gaster on the Metal Sucks podcast.
Correct.
I mean, you guys actually going to hit record tomorrow, or is it just set up and
It'll probably be more set up. We're gonna load in and start getting some sounds. Probably the following day we'll get into actually recording. It takes a little bit to get all the sounds going, and machine is very particular about where the mics go, and I am too. So it's going to be fun. Those first days in the studio are always exciting.
Well, and this is going to be the first time in his new setup here in Texas, right?
That is correct.
Yeah. So have you been out there to see it yet?
I've only seen photos of it.
It's pretty.
It looks very nice.
Yeah, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Now, at this point, when he starts like tuning your snare and stuff like that, I mean, do you even let him? I mean, at this point, you know what you want it to sound like, right?
Sure, absolutely. But he, you know, he's got an ear too. You know, we very much work closely together. Machine is a very unique individual in that he can say things to this band that no one else in the world can. And he manages to get away with it, and we listen to him on occasion. And it's great. He really is, he brings a tremendous amount of enthusiasm, and you can't pay for that. You know,
what's the secret? How does he do it?
He's really just a fan at heart, you know, and I think that's one of the best things that he really brings to the table is just being able to listen to the music and listen to the band as a fan, you know. We've been doing this for 25 years, and you know, sometimes we get a little, maybe tunnel vision or it's hard for us sometimes to really hear what's going on because we've been playing together for as long as we have. And he really does bring an outsider's perspective and some insight that I think other people wouldn't be able to bring.
Well, see, that seems sort of odd to think about when you think about the way that you guys have progressed on different records and the chances you guys have taken. It seems like you guys are pretty open-minded about what you're writing, too.
Absolutely. We try to be very open-minded about it. This time around, we made a tremendous amount of material. I mean, probably for every, 18 or 20 riffs, maybe one of them makes it to the table. And even then, that guy is an endangered species. I mean, you never know. You know, right up to the last minute, we're cutting stuff. And
see, I would think by now, like, you guys would have a system. It's like the dude, you know, somebody writes a riff, somebody writes something, you know whether the other three dudes are going to click with it or not, no?
Yeah, well, there's definitely an element there's a sort of an unspoken language that happens between the four of us when we're getting together to make songs. Very often, you know, several minutes go by without anybody actually saying anything, but there's a tremendous amount of activity happening in the room. I think that's just part of what happens when you've been a band for 25 years. You know, you really kind of learn to communicate with one another on a level that doesn't involve words.
Yeah. So now the 25 year thing is pretty amazing. I mean, that's obviously a milestone for not just any band can do it, can pull that off.
Yeah, like at 25 years, the Beatles, like half the Beatles are dead. Yeah. Led Zeppelin are wearing the corpses of old ladies. You know, I mean,
but you guys are.
Albums of the year.
Well, the other thing that I'm thinking of is that you guys are Iron Maiden or somewhere. You're touring for 3 months out of the year and playing a show every fourth day or something like that. You guys are touring constantly and playing constantly and always together. Has that gotten easier over the years for you guys, or is it harder? Do you hate looking at Neil after a while?
There's a lot of mutual respect that happens. We're very good at sort of staying out of each other's way. At this point, we sort of share a brain, so we kind of know where everybody's at. Touring can be tiresome. It can get monotonous at times, and so we do everything we can to sort of fight that. And for us, that means bringing some new energy into the set every night. So whether it means maybe changing the set list or putting some of these new songs in the set, trying different things for sound check, you know, we really try to stay away from having it sort of fall into a rut, because that's not fun for us, and it's certainly not fun for the audience.
See, I would have thought on this tour, like heading to the studio to record the new album, like us as an audience, we're going to hear the new album and Spacegrass, you know, and that's like it, right?
Well, you never know. That could happen.
I mean, I almost figured like you guys would like go through every song twice just to make sure, just to get ready, you know,
right.
That sort of thing.
Right. Well, we've been playing the new songs out quite a bit, and we tried different tweaks on them, that, you know, at night to night, just to see how things go. There's a special energy that happens when you actually play that song for the first time in front of an audience. You know, when you're sitting in the jam room and you're sort of micromanaging every bar, thinking about arrangement and what everybody else is playing, all that stuff sort of goes out the window as soon as you get in front of an audience, and that song comes to life. You learn a lot about the song. You learn a lot about the feeling of the song. You know, as a drummer, I'm always very mindful of where the pulse of that tune is. And so some songs work better when you push them a little bit, and some of them kind of work better when you pull them back. But those kinds of things really come into light when you play live.
At least with you guys, you know that you have the freedom that once it's recorded, you guys can still mess with it for years, because everybody expects a certain amount of that from
right,
you guys.
Right, right. And the song continues to evolve even after it's been recorded. You know, many of the songs that we play live are very different than the album versions. Hopefully they're better. You know, we get better at playing the songs.
Well, and different instrumentation, too. I mean, like, you can't replicate a lot of the stuff you have on Robot Hive with what you're bringing with the four piece.
Right. That's correct. And we try not to do that. We try not to replicate the record. You know, we try to make each evening be an honest musical event. And by that I mean that we try not to just get up there and just play a bunch of canned stuff, you know. We take chances live. There's improvisation that happens live. And that can go either way. Sometimes it can work out really, really great, and it's exciting and it's fun. And sometimes there can be a train wreck. But, you know, that's part of the experience. You know, that's the trade-off. Other bands are very good at getting out there and playing the same set, you know, for 9 or 10 months in a row, saying the very same things in between the songs and having the same samples and the same light rig and, you know, all this kind of stuff. I don't like that about rock and roll. That wasn't exciting to me when I was a kid. It's still not exciting for me now. And there's other bands who do it way better than we do.
Well, you guys have always seemed to be a little bit more in touch with your crowd, or a little bit more in that relationship that you have with an audience seems to be there with you guys more than a lot of other bands are out there. The Motley Crue or something like that. You know what I mean? It's on a different level.
Yeah, I think a lot of that has to do with the fact that there's going to be folks coming to the show tonight that have been seeing us play for 20 years. We used to play this room.
I know.
So, you know, who knows how many Clutch gigs you've seen, mm-hmm. and you've seen different interpretation of Big News One, and different interpretations of Spacegrass and 50,000 Unstoppable Watts, or whatever the case may be. The fans, I think, have grown to sort of expect that. You know, you're not going to get the same show that you saw last time or even last night.
Which is really part of the reason to keep coming back. I mean, when you guys did, I guess, when Emo's closed down.
Emo's here in Austin.
Austin. They closed down the one that was downtown. You guys did two gigs. Like, I think one was here, one was at the old, in the old little room.
Yeah,
that was
sure.
Just insane.
Yeah.
Because it was a complete two different sets both nights.
Yeah.
And it was great. It was one of the things not a lot of bands could actually pull that off, or would even bother to pull that off.
Well, we're very proud of that. We do something unique in this band, and that we change the set list every night. And the way we arrive at that is just having a different member of the band write the set list. So when the tour starts, Dan makes the first set list. then myself, and then Neil, and then Tim, and then we start all over again.
So whose set list do you consistently look at it and then turn to him and go, come on, not again? Is there like one dude who always messes with it?
And that's part of the thing. You know, very early on we said, look, let's adopt this method and see how it goes, but no one can complain. You know, you can't, if you're unhappy with the set list, then you just have to wait until it's your turn to make the set list, and then you can make it exactly how you want it.
I always figured that you guys were able to stay together for 25 years because you all married each other's sisters.
Yeah.
Is that not true?
That's not true.
How do you do it then?
I think it really goes back to the mindset that we were in when we started this band, you know, and you have to think back about, you know, when we were kids going to see shows, we used to go see bands like the Bad Brains and Fugazi and go-go shows like Chuck Brown and the Soul Searchers and EU and a lot of jazz gigs too. I used to go see Elvin Jones play and Billy Cobham and all these guys. So the musicians that I looked up to and that we as a band looked up to were not musicians that could fill arenas. They weren't on the radio. For the most part, the stuff that was on the radio was very uninteresting to all of us, you know. We set out to make a band that would play good shows and make good records. And that was really the beginning and the end of it.
But I imagine when Columbia calls, you got to start, you know, somebody has in the band's got to go, wait a minute, maybe we made a mistake here. Maybe we can get on the radio. You know, at some point, I mean, you guys have done more than one major label, right?
Sure, we've been on several major labels.
Yeah, so it's sort of like somebody at some point goes, oh, maybe we could. I mean, even now, you could be like, whoa, maybe this Walking Dead thing.
Well, you know, that never goes away, you know, yeah. You know, and it's still exciting. You never know. You always think to yourself, well, man, maybe this record's really going to go through the roof. You never know. And we're just grateful to be a band. I think at this point, you know, we were when we started the band, we had no idea that we were going to be able to make a career out of this. Here we are 25 years later, and thankfully, you know, we can make a living. And we don't take that for granted. And I think that's why we play as hard as we do and really work on the music as hard as we do. I practice every day. I think about the drums every day. I mean, I do this band 24 hours a day, 7 days a week.
I was going to say, we just walked in and you're sitting here tapping away as you're going. So
that's what I do.
It's how it rolls, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, but I would have thought by now you'd be able to play something a little bit more involved than that. You're just tapping the pad, you know?
It's all about the rhythm, though, right?
Probably, you know, yeah. As a non-drummer, probably, you know.
Well, I'll tell you, you know, the simple things for me, I get the most mileage out of, you know. Just speaking strictly from a drumming standpoint, you know, the more I play, the more I realize that the simplicity of the instrument is really where the beauty lies. More and more I realize that the drumming has very little to do with the physical, and it's much more of a mental thing. And so, you know, if before a set, my warm-up routine does not involve, you know, slamming the pad at, you know, 215 BPM trying to, you know, break somebody else's record. That's not interesting to me. I usually sit very quietly in a corner by myself with a metronome right around 60 BPM, playing very slow, simple things, and just being mindful of what it is I'm doing, lifting the sticks up off the pad, thinking about how quickly the sticks come back down. You know, there's the little details that really make a player who they are.
It's got to drive your wife nuts.
Yeah, I'm lucky to have a very patient wife. She will shut me down eventually, but I can play pretty late at night you know, unless she's got to get up early for the gym tomorrow, she's pretty flexible.
Stop tapping. Stop tapping.
We get into some of that sometimes at home. Yeah.
So why can't you sit still?
So at what point with Earth Rocker did you guys know you had a monster? Was it in the songwriting process? While you're recording, or not until after reviews and sales started coming in?
Well, we were very proud of the recording, really as soon as we got into the studio and started to cut the songs, and we realized this is a special record. We're doing something different on this album. We were very focused, and I think right away we had a good feeling that it was going to be a good album. The reception of the record is a completely different scenario, and you can't ever know. Just because the band feels like the record is a good record doesn't mean it's going to resonate
True.
with the people. Luckily it did, and for that, we're very grateful.
Well, that's when you get angry at Machine. Right? Well, hey, wait a minute, you're the fan, dude. You're supposed to tell us, right?
Well, too, I mean, it seems like Earth Rocker would be a, make a little more sense with the fans would go, yeah, okay, this is kind of a return to form, quote-unquote, you know, compared to Beale Street or Robot Hive, even, for that matter. And did you feel that same hesitation with those records as well, or did you feel like there's backlash on those?
Each record really is a snapshot of where the band is musically and creatively. And so, you know, on Robot Hive Exodus, we had an organist, and we had Eric playing harp on Beale Street, and he toured with us for quite some time. And that was fun. There was a lot of energy that happened on the stage because we had those other players. And then right before we went in to do Strange Cousins, we decided, you know what? Let's change it up. You know, you can't keep doing the same stuff over and over. So Strange Cousins, in my mind, was kind of a transition record. We were going back to just the four piece of the band, thinking about how to make those songs really translate without having that extra instrumentation. Mm-hmm. And then I think we really nailed it on Earth Rocker. Obviously, we're very proud of that one, and that record's been really, really good for us.
Looking pretty good, man. How are you feeling?
Feeling good.
Yeah?
Yeah, feeling really good.
I've seen you all over the place over the years, and this looking pretty svelte.
Yeah.
Well, taking care of yourself?
Yeah, I try to. I've dropped a few pounds in the last couple of years. It's no fun being on stage huffing and puffing and sweating, and, you know, it's not enjoyable for me, and it's certainly not enjoyable for the audience. I do the best I can. I try to take care of myself.
Is it rough when you're like on the road and touring and all that stuff to try to keep up any kind of regimen?
Yeah, that's very difficult. When I'm at home, I've got an elliptical machine, and I like riding that for a little bit every day. and I just try not to eat like a jerk, you know.
Is it easier to play? Is it make
certainly
like but everything is easier for you?
Everything's easier. I just really try to make drums the focus of everything that I do.
Yeah,
you make the whole. I hate to go back to this, but you make the four of us together for 25 years sound so easy. But at the same time, you've seen so many bands come and go.
Yeah, and a lot of those bands didn't subscribe to the two things that I talked about earlier: making good records and making good shows. That's really the thing that has, in my mind anyway, that's the thing that's carried the band, you know. When times got hard, we thought, well, we need to play a good show tonight because that's the only thing a band can do.
Wow.
Or when we go into the studio, we have to make a good record.
Has there ever been a point in your career where you guys got nervous that you might not be able to sustain or you might not be able to push through?
I think in those times, we just pushed even harder, you know.
When was that?
The late 90s were very difficult. We were still messing around with major labels, jumping from one to the other. I think at that time, too, we didn't realize it at the time, but you started to see the decline of that major label machine. And we got caught up in that, too, you know. The labels became much more selective about how they wanted to release music, when they wanted to release music. We would be under contract with a label, and we would say, look, we're ready to make a new album. And they would say, well, we're not really ready for you to make a new record, you know. And so then we would say, well, let's go book a tour. And then the booking agent that we would have at the time would say, well, you don't have a new album, so now what are you going to do? So it was very difficult. It was a battle. It wasn't a good time. It was hard. But, you know, from that time came Jam Room, which is probably one of the weirdest, craziest records we've ever made, you know, and I think that's kind of how we sort of made it through those times.
Was it you guys thought you needed the major label system, and it was sort of just a mind shift to kind of get away from it?
It was really the only game in town.
It's what you do.
It's, you know, there were certainly independent labels out there, but, you know, by that time we realized there's no such thing as a cool label, you know. An independent label is an independent label that wishes they were a major label. They just don't have the money or the funds to put behind a band, and that's really the end of the story. Other people will argue otherwise, you know, about creativity and sort of a DIY mindset and whatever they might have. But in my mind, that was a bunch of bullshit back then. You know, the little labels wanted to be big labels.
When you guys got caught up in a whole shitstorm of licensing and everything else with a lot of that too. So I mean that was a big mess.
It really was. It was difficult. The best thing that this band ever did was to start our own label, Weathermaker, and we've been doing that now for about 8 years. Immediately, everything just became more clear. You know, it was much easier to focus on fun stuff like, you know, jamming new riffs, and not having to get on the phone with the attorney and talk about some really dumb shit. You know, it allowed us to just to be a band.
So, is there an office somewhere with two ladies?
Well, you know, who my wife.
She runs it?
No, she does the day-to-day bookkeeping. We have a label manager, Stefan Koster. He does an amazing job, very dedicated individual. And Jack Flanagan, our manager, he's been managing us now for many, many years. He was on the road with us even before that, so we have a very good relationship with him. So between the three of them and ourselves, you know, we managed to do a pretty good job of running the label.
So they let you just be musicians, or do you guys still feel like you need to be involved in
the business
side?
We're still
involved in the business side of it. You know, everybody knows the monies that are coming in and going out. Everybody knows the kind of money that we're going to spend on promotions and advertising, and whether or not we're going to try to do a radio campaign. I mean, we've always been very hands-on, and I think that comes from you know, very early on, just coming up in the hardcore scene. You know, people made their own flyers and booked your own shows and pressed your own records, and that mentality never left the band. Even when we were on the major labels, we were still very cognizant of that, and anytime we could take a situation into our own hands, we did.
But at the same time, with a major label or something like that, those books are kind of closed to you, so you don't get to see half of that stuff. So that makes it even harder to deal with, right?
Yeah, we realized very early on that the monies that came from a major label were going to be few, if any.
Yeah.
And we knew that going into it. You know, that was just part of the racket. They were going to give you some money to make a record, and then pretty much you could just kiss all the other stuff goodbye. So you better get in the van and you better tour your ass.
I think
off.
You guys only had one real radio push that was careful with that mic, and that was like the one thing that they really shoved.
Right.
And
right.
After that, it was like.
Yeah, that was the closest thing we had to sort of of an active rock radio single.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. So was it? What is the status on all of those albums? Will any of them ever become yours?
Well, at this point, really, the only records that we don't own are Transnational Speedway League, self-titled Elephant Riders, and Pure Rock Fury. The three records that we did with DRT, Blast Tyrant, Robot Hive, and Beale Street, Weathermaker releases those now. Our very first 7-inch Pitchfork, we own that now. I would say that probably those four records that I was talking about, we will never see the rights to those. As far as I know, Elephant Riders is actually even out of press.
Yeah, that sucks.
At this
love
point. You know, that's the reality of it.
Well, I mean, it was you guys heralded when you got back Blast Tyrant and when you got back the DRT era, because I mean, you re-released them on Weathermaker, and there's like all the bonus stuff that you guys have put out with it, and
yeah,
I mean, there's a ton of stuff. So I mean, it must have been pretty exciting to be able to get that material back in the house, right?
No doubt about it. Very, very exciting. We're grateful that the thing just kind of worked out that way.
It's interesting because watching back your career, it just always feels like you guys have done the right moves at the right time. And I mean that by, like, before we started talking, I'm talking to you about Milwaukee Metal Fest, and you guys were like, everybody's like, what the hell is this, right?
Yeah.
And that was before Transnational, I think, the first time I saw you. And but you were right ahead of the curve because 3-4 years later, when you guys are doing your self-titled album and everybody's talking about Clutch, like every other metal band's like, we can't get anybody to show up to our shows.
Yeah.
And you guys were ahead of it, and you guys were on the right labels, or maybe not specifically, but in the right place at the right time. How much of that is conscious, and how much of that has been dumb luck?
Well, you know, all of it's luck, man.
but I don't believe in luck, so what? It must be...
When we were in the middle of it, you know... When we did that metal fest that you described, I remember having a good time, yeah. But I also remember looking at all those blank faces out there and thinking to myself, man, this is not going well right now, you know? And, you know, and then a few years later, maybe we were on tour with Marilyn Manson, and same kind of reception from the audience. I'm thinking to myself, man, this is kind of this is terrible. They really don't care for this music at all. When we came to town 6 months later, there was kids with Marilyn Manson t-shirts in the front row. So, you know, when you're in it, you don't really think about it like that. You just think to yourself, man, we better just do a good ass job. We better just play our asses off because that's the only thing we got.
So it's just self-belief.
Yeah.
Just as long as I know that what I'm doing today, I'm going to feel good about it tomorrow, I'm going to be all right.
Yep.
So now when you guys grab these dudes for the label, because now you're putting out other bands' stuff, how do you go about picking and choosing who...
Make sure you own the masters.
Well, you know, at this point, we've only released one other band outside of side projects of the guys. Tim did a project called Big Swell. Mm-hmm. Very different sounding than Clutch. Neil did the company band. So in one way, it's sort of been an outlet to put those side projects out. But with the Lion Eyes thing, we've known those guys for many, many years. I originally met them at my drum teacher's house, Walter Saab. And Walter was he was a crotchety old individual. And he was a great teacher and really believed in music, but he had a very abrasive way about him. And I can remember very specifically going to his house, and the Lion Eyes guys at the time, they were just kids, they were in high school. And their drummer at the time was taking lessons from Walter, and he soon left the band. And these kids kept coming over to Walter's house, you know, like, why are you guys over here taking this abuse? You know, I gotta come over here for drum lessons. But, you know, here you are. He's just, you know, and just, so right away I knew that these guys were special guys, and they continued to impress me with their work ethic, with their musicality, and it just worked out. You know, it was an opportunity for us to put some music out for a band that we really believed in, and we're proud of them. You know, they're going to be on the show tonight.
That's interesting, because like whenever I go for like a poker coach or a surfing coach, I go for the like angriest, most abrasive coach I can, because I know they're going to keep me focused.
Right.
Is that the same thing you got with
Walter? Yeah, he was a very special guy in that way. He started playing professionally in 1946, so that Whoa. You know, so you got to think about it from that perspective. And, you know, in a lot of ways, that sort of abrasive personality that he had was really a way, I think, for him to cut through a lot of shit. More than once, I took drummer friends over who were not as thick-skinned and not as dedicated to the music. And Walter saw that immediately. And so, you know, these insults and these racial epithets and whatever else he could conjure up drove those people away. But for him... all the better, because he didn't want to deal with people who weren't there for the real reason.
Wasting his time.
Exactly. Wasting his time. One thing that I never forget that he said is, you know, if you're a musician and you have a plan B, then that's your plan B. You know what I'm saying? So So if in the back of your head you're thinking, well, I'm going to do this band, but, you know, in a couple years, really, I'm going to go back to school and I'm going to do accounting work. Really, you're going to go back to school and do accounting work. Yeah. And I think that's very much the way Walter lived his life.
That sounds like really awful advice nowadays. Well, and all right, so real quick, because everybody's going to want to know, do you have a name for the new album?
No name for the new album.
Do you have song titles?
We have working song titles at this point. Uh-huh. One of them is called Motorhead, because it sounds like Motorhead.
I imagine that would probably change, so,
yeah, and then there's, you know, like ZZ Funk, and, you know, like, you know, silly titles like that. But you got to call it something, you know. You got to name it something, and usually those silly titles don't stick, but once in a while they do.
Does it feel like to you? I think a lot of people probably. All right, a lot of people. I think people will agree with me that it feels like Clutch have got almost like two distinct styles that you transitioned into and transitioned very recently out of. So does it feel that way inside, or does it all feel like one big beast?
It's all music to me.
I knew you were going to say that.
It's all music to me. You know, I'm just subdividing my life. You know, that's really what it is. I look at music and I think about how do I make sense of that? How do I subdivide that quarter note? You know, you could take a quarter note, you could split it two ways. You could split it in half or you could split it in three. And then you can split those in half or in three. And so that's what I'm thinking about when we're making music. I'm looking at that music. I'm thinking about that riff and how are these guys subdividing that? How do I make sense of that?
Yeah, but when the acoustic guitars are getting dusty, then you know you're on this side of the sandwich, you know?
Right. It's all music, man.
See, that's the mathematical drummer. That's the, you know, that's the way you think about it.
And so, all right, assuming that I'm right and you're wrong about Clutch.
Yep. All right.
Would the next album be Earth Rocker?
Where does it land on the spectrum?
Yeah.
Well, there's definitely a good bit of it is sort of a continuation of the kind of energy that we hit on Earth Rocker. Mm-hmm. I think on Earth Rocker we got good at playing upbeat songs. You know, we've always had, you know, one or two of those on a record, but Earth Rocker was the first one in a long time that was really consistently upbeat. Having played that style for a couple years now, I'm better at it. You know, yeah. I just do that thing better now, and it didn't used to be one of my strong suits. So we're more versed at that approach, and I feel like the songs that are a continuation of Earth Rocker are some of that same feeling, but even better. You know, the detail in it I think is more apparent, and again, it's all about subdividing stuff. I'm more aware of how to put those beats where they need to be.
Right. Were you guys surprised that you didn't get more of the? Two questions. Were you surprised you didn't get more of the like video game placements and the TV placements that seem to be happening more with the sort of bluesy style stuff that you guys have been doing previously? Was that a surprise or not a surprise, or do you not care?
Yeah, I mean, we don't really think about it too much like that. Like, this will be a good song for a video game. You know, we just try to make the best songs that we can. You know, wherever the inspiration really is, we follow it. You know, we try a lot of stuff. You know, in the jam room, we'll say, you know, let's just work on acoustic things. You know, let's try to get some acoustic things going. And we might come up with 3, 4, 5 different ideas. But if one of those ideas doesn't really resonate with the band, we don't force it. You know, you can't force something like that. The best songs, I think, are the ones that come together with the least amount of effort.
So how do those deals come about when something like that happens, like the Walking Dead thing? Because when I listen to Earth Rocker, I mean, there are several songs where I get a visual of it. You know, like my favorite song on the record is The Face. It's probably like hands down my favorite song because it just provides this epic sort of visualization for me. So, I mean, is that the label side that does that? Is the band that... You know, or is it people that come to you guys and go,
people come to us. People come to us these days, and I think really what's happened is that there was, you know, a lot of folks, you know, in their teens and early 20s who appreciated the music, appreciated the band, would go see the shows live, and now those people are professionals, and some of them
Jackass.
Yeah. So some of those people are you know, designing video games, and some of those people are in movies or commercials, and so they pick their favorite bands, you know, and sometimes those bands, or sometimes that band is Clutch.
Yeah, it should be every time. Because my favorite song on Earth Rocker is the whole album, but just. I gotta have to check.
It's just that's the one that I just kept going back to over and over and over and over again. I don't know why.
We're super excited for the new album. Do the wives and I assume everybody's got kids? No.
I don't have kids.
You don't have kids?
No. Uh-uh.
Wow.
No, my wife and I.
On the others.
Yeah. No. Thank you. I like them.
Yeah.
I think they're great.
Yeah.
I just don't want them living in my house.
How many have the all three of the other guys ever come up to you and gone, "Hey, look, I need to bring the kid for the weekend on, you know, for between this date and that date"? Has that gone on?
No, you know, and we're pretty good at keeping it separate. You know, we learned very early on watching other bands who brought wives or girlfriends on the road that really is that's just an invitation for trouble. All kinds of things happen when you start to delve into that.
Especially whose wife?
You got it. It's a working environment. You know, it's you know, people have this idea that, oh, you're traveling around in a bus and, you know, doing all these gigs and stuff. But this thing is basically a submarine. You know, and we're in dirty ass nightclubs every night, and it's dark, and we play hard and late, and you know, it's not a family.
Well, and you got to maintain that level of focus that you were talking about earlier. You know, I mean, like if anything paying attention over here, if the kid scrapes his knee on a beer bottle out back.
But you want to keep the same lineup. You don't want somebody going, I'm starting to get a little homesick about so and so. You know, you don't want that either.
Right, right. You know, maybe one day the band will be so huge that everybody can have their own tour bus and they can bring their families. Until that happens, you know, we this is a working environment.
Is there ever a time like I'm getting married? Going to be a lot of expenses. Can we tour so that I can have? You know, how much does everybody's personal expenses and relationships get into the business of income production for the band?
You know, we tour constantly because we need to pay mortgages. You know, I mean, that's what we do. You know, I can't really remember a time where a band member was like, oh, well, we got to go on tour because I need this. You know, we're all in this together. Everybody makes the same, you know. So we all have homes and we all have wives and car payments and, you know, all that kind of taxes, you know, all that kind of stuff. So we stay busy because we have to stay busy.
So is Weathermaker like based in the Cayman Islands just for the
the
shelter? I guess that's the other question is it always been like a total everybody gets an equal thing on everything that we do?
Sure.
Yeah?
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
And has that been critical, you think, to the
survival? Doubt about it. No doubt about it.
Has there ever been a point where you're like, yeah, but he doesn't lug my drums?
No. No, we don't usually get into those kinds of. It just doesn't happen, you know.
Yeah, but I mean, at some point you probably go, I don't know. I feel like I'm working a little bit harder than the other guy.
Everybody has a skill set in this
I gotta
band.
Do the interviews.
Everybody. Well, we split up the interviews too. You know. I mean, it's like that. So, we try to. It's very much a democracy. It's very much a four-way split. For everything, you know, for everything from songwriting credits to financials. I mean, you know, we're in this together.
Have there been bands that you guys have toured with, especially bands that you've done a lot of time with, where when they're coming apart, anybody's ever called you and said, how do I salvage this thing? How do I keep it going? And you wish that there was something you could have done. You know what I mean?
I do know what you mean. That has not happened.
What's wrong with everybody? You'd be the first person I'd call.
I don't know. I think they look at us and just think we're four incredibly boring people. And why would we want to be anything like that band?
Really?
I think so.
Is that what you think?
I'm pretty sure about it.
With that time you spend together, and that the level of success that you guys have had, at least relationship-wise and sticking together, it seems like that's... I want to know. You know something that some other people don't know. And you know what I mean? It's like you would know. You know, you're the Dr. Phil. Tell me what am I doing wrong? I can't get along with my guitar.
The Corrosion of Conformity guys never called up and said, we can't make this work. What's going on?
No way. They never called. No. I love those guys, and we see them all the time. In fact, I just saw Pepper the other night when we were in New Orleans. He's very excited about getting back together with his friends at COC, and I can't wait for that. You know, I love COC. All versions of the band. You know, I can't say anything bad about those guys. Those records have been, they've been the soundtrack to, you know, my very earliest endeavors in rock and roll and heavy metal, all the way up through the more, you know, rock sound and stuff that they did in the 90s and the three-piece thing. I just saw the three-piece band play not too long ago, 3 or 4 months ago, and it was amazing. Playing better than ever. Mm-hmm. You know, Reed Mullen was such an influence on me when I was a kid. I loved the energy that he had, and watching those three guys play together is, those guys own time. They somehow managed to stretch and compress time in a way that no other band can do. They have a very special musical bond, and for me that's very exciting to watch.
Yeah.
It'll be interesting to see Pepper jump back into the middle of that to see how that works out.
Well, yeah, we'll see how that works out. Yeah, those guys have been playing hard for a long time, man. They've got their chops are up. They're playing really good, Pepper's got his work cut out for him.
Yeah, cut him at South By, and it was brutal. I mean, I wasn't expecting it, you know, because I was used to the, you know, the Pepper era stuff is more so. I hadn't seen the three piece before that, and it's like, oh my God, this is amazing,
awesome stuff. And I like it in a way too. It's almost like, it's kind of a history lesson, you know, when you think about for how long those guys have been playing together and the kinds of stuff that they listen to and the sound that they came up with. Completely unique. No one else was doing that, and they're still like that.
Did you marry a Clutch fan?
She was a Clutch fan, but I've known my wife for a very, very long time, and she loves the band. Yes, she does.
She knew you first before she knew what you did?
I don't think she did, actually. I remember going to...
It wasn't like a merch table romance.
No, it was nothing like that. It was at a show, though, when I first met her.
Yeah?
Yeah, it was. It was, who was playing? I think it was an Internal Void show. You guys know Internal Void?
No.
Internal Void, Maryland has a killer doom scene. The Obsessed, you know, with Wino. He sort of spawned this whole scene that happened from there. And so from The Obsessed, you got bands like Internal Void, and you got bands like Iron Man and Wretched, and really, really great bands. Internal Void, they've been playing doom metal since probably about 1985, you know? And I think I met her at an Internal Void show, actually.
Not a Clutch show.
No, it was not a Clutch show.
So is she a doomer? What do you call it? A doomer?
Yeah, she is, man. St. Vitus. Yeah, heck yeah. Trouble. Wow. All that stuff. She loves that stuff.
See, I always got nervous about dating Smiths fans and doom fans.
Yeah.
I don't think I could do it.
Well...
But it worked for you.
It did. It worked out quite nicely.
Did she just do everything slow? I can't figure anybody else.
Absolutely not.
I got to say, I still love those guys, man. I donated my money to help the Tasmanian Devils with that last song that I bought.
Oh, is that right? Oh, that's right, because they're Australian, aren't they?
Yeah, well, it came out, September, October. Like, it's called Echoes to Come, and that one came out a while back, and they did it for charity.
Yeah.
To help save Tasmanian Devils or whatever.
So, dude,
good for them.
If those motherfuckers could spin like crazy and then, like, you know, go ha, 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 ha afterwards, I'd give my money, but they don't.
I don't think that's what they do,
They
man.
Don't do that.
I don't think that's how it works.
I'm at my whole
that's like adult. That's like everybody in Texas.
Yeah.
You know, it's the same thing. It's the same idea. Everybody down there carries a big knife and has a hat with teeth on it.
Yeah, exactly.
No, it's not how it works, dude.
I know, but I guess if my adulthood's going to be disappointing about what's true about Tasmanian Devils, then... You can't ask me to give money to
them. There are even pictures online of Psychroptic cuddling with a little soft hand.
Yeah, you can't cuddle. No,
they're so cute. Look at how cute they are. What a cute little Tasmanian devil. That's cute. I bet there'll be a couple of Australians on this trip we're about to take.
70,000 tons of metal, people. And check this out. If you're coming onto the boat, look for us. And because we don't know when this is happening, and we don't know where it's happening, and we don't even necessarily have a lot of confidence that it is happening.
Hey, man, we're going to do our best to actually do some stuff live in front of you guys. It's basically what's going to happen.
Live interviews.
I think what might happen is I may become a usurper, find this this on-air lounge or whatever on the boat, and just take over. Like, plug all my shit in, and we just start talking on the microphone and be done with it, dude.
So look for us, because it's going to be really cool. We get to ask like embarrassing questions now in front of a number of people.
Yeah, you can never do that shit live, so it's all good.
Are you challenging me?
No. No, I am not.
2015's a new year, man.
Yeah, it'll be the year that I walk off the podcast. See you later.
You try to walk off the boat, done. Man. You try to walk off the boat.
I'll just walk over to the bar and grab a drink. Fuck it. I'm out of here. Oh, God damn it. No. Don't ask Nergal about his penis, please. All right.
Wow, there's things people want to know.
That's true. There probably is. I'll tell you what, man. It'll be interesting. Still waiting on a few bands to be announced. But yeah, it's going to be sailing out this week on my birthday.
Congratulations. Yeah, happy birthday.
I guess. You're coming up too. So Yeah, lots of, it'll be a lot of fun. It was a lot of fun last year, so. And, of course, you will get the backhaul on that. You know, once we do a bunch of interviews, we'll post it on the podcast coming up once we get back and all that. So that'll be a good time, man.
Yeah.
So, yeah, lots of good stuff coming. I think next week we might throw a story time from Stavros in. We got a...
it's a good one.
Yeah.
Featuring the members of Metallica, might add.
In a certain way.
In a way.
He actually is brilliant, I got to tell you. And... And dude, he I was looking on Facebook, and he's going to be doing like a it's what sounds like a almost live story time.
Oh, cool.
So it's like him and a couple other dudes that are doing like a Q&A / storytelling thing live in Chicago. And I was like, oh, that actually sounds really cool, man. Yeah. So because he's a great storyteller. That's why we invite him in.
Absolutely.
So, yeah, we're going to have him on the podcast next week to tell another. It's the extension of the New Orleans story. So if you know the Eaglehead New Orleans story, this is like tied into it as well. So there's. Yeah, then and the back on the New Orleans story with all the we met that guy at Housecore. And,
well, you did. I never met him.
Yeah, dude. It's, yeah.
So wow. Awesome.
Wow. Small fucking world when it comes to this metal thing, man. It really is, dude. So make sure you subscribe to the Metal Sucks podcast so that you can get it to your device every week.
SpeakPipe.
Yeah, SpeakPipe, look for that every time we post metalsucks.net at the bottom of the post. You can click on a thing and you can leave us a message. So if you think something about a song or you think something about what we say that that Godless is full of shit about Exodus, you can let us know on the SpeakPipe. So make sure you leave us a message that way. You can also tweet us. I am at Bearded Ape on Twitter.
I am at Godless Speaks.
So that's yet another way that you can get a hold of us. And of course, we post every Monday at metalsucks.net. I am Chuck.
I'm Godless.
And this is another episode of the Metal Sucks podcast.